A warm welcome to all you students of Confirmation. I know it has been a long journey since June, and I'm sure we have done well to prepare for that great day of Confirmation, when we will stand up for Jesus and accept Him as our Lord and Master on the basis of our own personal faith. The time of Lent has really helped us in our preparation. Well, as we begin today's session, I would like to, as usual, begin with a short episode, and then we'll have a discussion and a few questions. I'm sure you must be listening to a lot of news about President Trump these days, but I would rather like to tell you a story of another American president, Andrew Jackson, some 200 years ago from today. The story is entitled Pardon Refused. When Andrew Jackson was the president of the United States, a man was given a court trial and condemned to die. And as you know, like India, even in the United States, the president has a power to condone the death sentence of a convict. And therefore, President Andrew Jackson offered to pardon him. But for reasons unknown, the condemned man refused to accept the pardon after his petition was accepted by the president. The prison authorities, the attorney general, and others earnestly endured to convince the man to accept the pardon. Everyone was startled. How could a person refuse a pardon? They therefore tried to impress to this man that it would not only save his life, but if he did not accept the pardon, it would be an insult to the president. The man persisted. Now, this was a typical situation. A very serious legal question arose. Therefore, the Attorney General consulted the Supreme Court, asking whether legal authorities could enforce the man to receive the pardon. The court considered this issue and finally came to a conclusion that the pardon was merely a printed statement until the man accepted it. If the man rejected it, the pardon remained only a printed matter. I'm sure this was a very interesting topic. And without straying into the nitty-gritties and just focusing on what we heard, here are a few questions for your discussion. First, do you think the decision of the court was a good decision? Or do you think they should have let the man go free? Give reasons. Second, why do you think the man refused the pardon? Third, if the man refused the pardon not because of anger or stubbornness, but because he felt he deserved the punishment, would you call such a man a good person? Why or why not? And the fourth question, do you have difficulty in deciding what is good or evil? Describe your difficulty. Well, I'll give you some time to ponder and think, and then we will move ahead with the lesson. This would have been a very interesting topic to discuss, and if it was an ordinary class, there would be many views. However, I guess some of your views, and I would like to place them opposite the questions. For the first question, many would say it was a fair decision because the court did not force its opinion, but rather gave a choice. For the second question, some would feel since the man accepted the guilt, he wanted to pay the price for his mistake. Well, others would also feel that he was proud and therefore He did not want any favor. For the third question, many felt that he was a good person, but he refused to accept pardon because he was afraid to face the world after committing the crime. And for the fourth question, everybody feels that it is both easy and at the same time difficult to decide what is good or evil. And this is basically because avoiding evil is a big problem due to lack of knowledge and maturity. The climax of a discussion boils to a point which humankind has been grappling since the time of creation, that is, the choice of good and evil. Though we are graced by divine life in the sacraments of initiation, the CCC very clearly says we all are in earthly tents, and this new life given to us can be weakened and even lost by sin. And therefore, the CCC says, those who approach the sacrament obtain God's mercy for the offenses committed against the church and God. And this is precisely what we are going to learn today through the lesson, Sin and the Sacrament of Reconciliation. Let me begin by asking you, what is sin? I am sure you must have heard this word so many times throughout your catechesis. According to Wikipedia, the word sin is derived from the root word amartia, a Greek word, which literally means missing the mark. But according to Christianity, it is an immoral act, which is a transgression of the divine law. So in simple word, it means it's an act of disobedience, something like a breach of freedom, which results in a break of relationship between man and God. I'm sure that you remember that we studied about the Beatitudes, that they are the pathways, something like a roadmap towards our destination to reach the kingdom of God. And we also learned about the commandments, that they are guidelines. They are not boundaries which indicate the limits which cannot be crossed. Rather, they are guidelines which help us to remain in God's love. Sin is an offense against God and neighbor. It is the failure of genuine love for God and neighbor caused by excessive attachment to self and certain goods. Sin is thus a rupture in communion or relationship with God and neighbor. Jesus gave the blueprint of a good life when he answered the Pharisees and the teachers of the law who wanted to trap him by saying, which is the greatest commandment? He simply said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. So Jesus teaches us that a good person has to have a proper relationship. He has to have a good relationship with God, with himself, and with his neighbor. Now let us go step by step into this three-dimensional triangle. Let us begin with the first aspect, our relationship with God. There are very simple and basic rules in our response to God. The first is, we need to acknowledge Him. Second, we need to respect Him. And third, we need to worship Him. You will recollect that we have done this. Yes, we did all these three when we did the commandments, the first three commandments. A good person also needs to have an open relationship with oneself. It is universally accepted that there are five basic rights every human needs in life. First, the gift of life itself. Everyone has the right of his own life, physical and mental health, and all the things he needs in order to live, like air, water, food, and sunshine. And nobody else can take his life without his consent. Second, the right of freedom. This is one of the greatest gifts which God has given us. A free will, the power to choose, to make our own decisions, and to do what we have to do with our own lives. Third, the right of truth. This includes our intellect, the power to understand, to know the truth about ourselves and the world. Fourth, the right of property. Everyone has a right to a certain amount of property, his own house to live, the land, space around him. Fifth, the right of sexual integrity. This includes the right to determine one's own state of life, married or single, religious, right to raise a family, to privacy. A good person has a proper relationship with others also, because we don't stay alone in the world. We live in a community. And just as we ourselves have the five inalienable rights, so also others have and enjoy these same basic rights. We cannot take away others' life. We have to respect their freedom, the right of truth for them. We cannot confiscate somebody else's property, and we have to respect the sexual integrity of others. This simple diagram shows the perfect relationship we need to have with God, with ourselves, and with neighbor. It is interconnected, which binds each one to the other in true love. One of the key constituent to remain connected and to have proper relationship. The central message of the good news was, God hates sin, not the sinner. When Jesus was criticized for hanging out with the sinners and outcasts, he replied in Luke 5:31-32, "Those who are well do not need a doctor. I have come not to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance." In John 3:16, it's very clearly said, "God so loved the world that he sent his Son, that the world shall not be condemned, but saved." Hence, Jesus began his ministry announcing a special time of God's favor to the lost, least, and the last. That is, those who were considered outcast and sinners by the Pharisees. Hence, the call for conversion was an essential part of the proclamation of the kingdom of God. You have all heard and know the meaning of this word, turning point. It means a moment of decisive change in situations due to some action. In the parable of the prodigal son, we can clearly see a particular moment which proves to be the turning point in the life of this man. He is prompted into the entire process of conversion and repentance. Hence, this parable of Jesus, which is par excellence, is extremely helpful to ponder and reflect in our own lives and to recognize our own selfishness and turn back to God's love. It's a process of conversion linked stage to stage. Let me explain to you very clearly. The first is the stage of contrition. This point of contrition is dealt in Luke chapter 15 verses 11 to 18. It literally means a state of feeling remorse When we do something wrong, our conscience pricks us and we are not at peace. It is this realization or regret of one's action and acceptance of the fault which is called contrition. Thus, in a way, it is coming to one's senses and accepting a mistake or blunder. In the parable, the turning point is when the son realizes his mistake, that he has done wrong by walking out of his father's house. Contrition is not easy, but surely not impossible. There are many who are not ready to accept their own mistake, and there are also some who, after accepting their fault, feel that saying sorry will not work. This is the mental block, a major concern for many people in this world to sort out their relationship with others, leading to stress and agony. Overcoming this block and acceptance of one's fault is the first step in the process of repentance. In our relationship with God, this block is faced by many, as described by the late Pope St. John Paul II, a saintly man who said, "It is the death of conscience to listen to God's inner voice." The second step and the stage in the turning point is confession, which is dealt in the verses 20-21. Confession literally means a formal statement admitting one's guilt. Accepting one's mistake in private by itself is not easy for many. So you can imagine how much courage it will require to stand up and declare in front of others one's mistake. The parable tells us vividly that the son, after acknowledging his guilt, did not stop there. He made the firm decision to walk back and openly confess his mistake. Many a times we accept our mistakes privately, but we do not have the courage to face the other person. The main reason for this is a pride and ego, which does not allow us to confess our guilt. Maybe we are ashamed or frightened, or sometimes feel what others will talk about us. In our relationship with God too, it is the unwillingness to face the priest in the confessional. Our thoughts are, what will he think about me? How shall I face him after the confession when he meets me later on? But please remember, the priest in the confessional sits as the representative of Jesus Christ, and you are confessing your sins to Jesus. So let this not be a stumbling block in your step towards repentance. The third step or the stage in the point of repentance is satisfaction. It is dealt in the verse 19b. Satisfaction means ready to make amends by paying the price or compensation for the offense. We know in the parable that after admitting his guilt and the public confession, the son was ready to make reparation by paying the price for his sin. He said he is ready to be treated as a slave because he has offended his father. Let us not confuse satisfaction with fine or penalty, which is usually imposed on a guilty person for breaking the law. Satisfaction is rather compensation willingly accepted by the offender in order to offset the wrong or injury done to the other person. Our repentance will not be genuine if we are unwilling to fulfill our satisfaction. In our relationship with God, many feel the penance given by the priest is like a fine or a penalty. That is not true. Rather, true satisfaction would be avoiding the temptation to fall again into sin and trying to live as a child of God. The last and the final step, but the very crucial stage in the journey of repentance is reincorporation. It literally means an act of giving back the earlier status or making the other feel accepted and included. In the story, it's not the son who is the only hero, but it is also the father. The father recognizes the contrite heart of the son and goes overboard in reincorporating him into his home, dresses him for the feast, celebrates with a fatted calf, and even wants the elder son to rejoice at the return of the prodigal son. Thus, it is the father who plays the biggest role in the climax, or else the climax would have been very dull, sad, and boring. Sinners will not experience full acceptance and forgiveness unless they are welcomed back joyfully. It is giving back the proper status, not holding back on anything from the past, a time of healing and reunion, a time of celebration. The story of man's sin and return to grace is a complex one, but rich in promise. It can be fully experienced only in the sacrament of penance and reconciliation. As the CCC 1448 says very clearly, it comprises of two equally essential elements. On the one hand, the acts of man who undergoes conversion through the action of the Holy Spirit, namely contrition, confession, and satisfaction. On the other hand, it is God's action through the intervention of the church. The church, who through the bishop and its priest forgives sin in the name of Jesus Christ and determines the manner of satisfaction. It also prays for the sinners and does penance for him. Thus, the sinner is healed and re-established into the ecclesial communion, that is, entering back into God's grace. So, to put it in very simple words, the sacrament of reconciliation is a sacrament of healing. It provides us with the opportunity to enter back into God's grace. So, to put back the learning in a gist, it is: sin is a breach of God's love because God is love. God is patient and kind. God is always waiting for us with open arms. Kindly relax. Take a comfortable posture. Keep everything aside and try to concentrate on your breathing. Close your eyes. Breathe in, and as you breathe in, thank God for all that God has given you. And as you breathe out, give out all your anxieties and worries, fully knowing that God is taking care of you. Try to feel the presence of God all around you. We will be listening to God's word from the Bible, the words will appear on the screen. I request you to gently open your eyes and follow the reading. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. A reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, verses 25 to 32. Now the eldest son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he got him back safe and sound." Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, "Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you and never disobeyed your command. Yet you never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came back, who devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him?" Then the father said to him, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we have to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found." The word of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pause to ponder and reflect on the word of God. I request you to kindly close your eyes and spend some time in silence. You may gently open your eyes now. We will review the scene we heard regarding the elder brother refusing to join the celebration, even when the father requested him to come in. What is your opinion about the elder brother? What do you feel could be the reason for his refusal? Is he proud that he looks down on his younger brother, and that he is not like him who has wasted his father's property on vices and in wrong company? Or is he jealous because his brother will again have a share in the father's property? Or is he self-righteous, even to the extent that he is not ready to accept the father's views and trying to show off his goodness in defiance, and in the process by not being humble and obedient at all to his father? What is your opinion about such people? Are there any long-term consequences of being self-righteous? Will it be difficult for such people to forgive others and to receive forgiveness? Well, it may seem for many that the scene of the elder brother is a sudden twist in the climax. No, it is not so. Actually, Jesus intended to send out a strong message through this parable. He knew that the proud and the self-righteous would never be ready to listen to him. And hence, he says, "I have come to call the sinners to repentance." Let us now reflect and gaze in our own lives. Am I ready to turn back to the Father in humility? Or am I self-righteous and proud that even I am not ready to humble myself before God? What type of person would I like to be in my relationship with God? Would I be contrite and humble? Or proud and self-righteous? Is it the pride that stopped the prisoner in the beginning story to accept the release as shared by some? Yes, it is also a cause for many for not going for confession, thinking that they have not done anything wrong or they do not have anything to confess. Let us close our eyes in prayer to ponder deeply, and let us make a prayer in a word or a line, praying especially on the aspect dealt by the parable. We will now all join in singing a hymn, and let the words of this hymn be a prayer for each one of us.
Keep us apart.
Let us sign ourselves as we conclude this time of prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Catechism of the Catholic Church clearly tells us that there are two ways of celebrating the sacrament of penance and reconciliation. The first is the individual form, and second is the communitarian form. Let us now discuss each in detail. The individual form of confession is well known to many of us. The details of this are contained in the CCC 1480. The first step is greetings and blessings. Just like the father was waiting for his son in the parable, the priest welcomes the penitent and blesses him or her who comes to receive God's forgiveness in the sacrament of confession. Reading the Word of God. To get inspired from the message of love and forgiveness, the Word of God serves as a powerful tool to illuminate our conscience, elicit contrition, and exhort repentance. We usually don't see it in use presently, but it is the proper way. Hence, many people do spend time praying and reading the Word of God before coming for confession. The third step is confession and acknowledging of our sins. This is the actual conveying all our faults and weaknesses that we have done to the priest. It is followed by imposition and acceptance of penance. That is, being ready to pay the price for feeling sorry for having offended God. Then comes absolution. In the name of Jesus Christ, the priest will absolve us from all our sins. The next step is the prayer of thanksgiving and praise. Just as there was joy and happiness in the parable when the son returned, there is happiness and joy in God's house because a sinner who was lost in sin is now saved and back into God's family. And finally, dismissal and blessing. The priest blesses the penitent and commands him or her to sin no more and to remain in God's love and grace. The second form is the communitarian form. It is well known to people who have attended retreats. The details of this form are contained in the CCC 1482, which are as follows. It begins with greetings, that is the usual opening rites of a liturgical celebration. There is the liturgy of the Word of God and homily to reflect on a passage from the Bible and the word being broken for the benefit of all. Next is examination of conscience in common. There is some time spent in prayer so as to lead the people into a reflection as a community of God. Next follows is the community as a whole ask for forgiveness through the penitential rite. It is followed by a common prayer. And which other prayer can be greater than the Lord's Prayer, the Our Father? It concludes with a common thanksgiving, and then each individual goes for confession separately. Out of these two ways of celebrating the sacrament of penance and reconciliation, which one do you find more satisfying? And can you have some reasons for the same? I would like to quote CCC 1484 in conclusion, which clearly says, individual integral confession and absolution remain the only ordinary way for the faithful to reconcile themselves with God and the Church. Unless physical or moral impossibility excuses from this kind of confession.